combination of those different ones. But let's begin with this scripture. John chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. In the beginning was the Word that already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everyone, to everything that was created, and his light brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. Light is such an interesting thing, and I'm surrounded by very bright lights. I'm almost illuminated. There's a Japanese company called Team Lab. And in Team Lab, what they do is they create experiences around light. And so it's one thing to see a picture. It's another thing to experience it in video. I'm seeing if this is going to work. Something about light. How it expels darkness. I'd love to go to one of their experiences because I'm sure it's unlike any other. Biggie, you're going to have to help me when I put my hand up so it just clicks in. Imagine the power of light. Light seems to put to flight despair. It illuminates. It takes away the darkness. There's something about its power. Let's turn off those lights. Except when it doesn't. Except when there seems to be a darkness. And I think that the older that I get, it's very easy to let the darkness begin to shape our narrative. This is a storm. I believe in the Caribbean. And it's just this ominous darkness that is coming in. And when we look around the world, we see darkness. Not only in the world, but in ourselves. You don't have to read the newspaper very long, watch the news, to look at and see wars and the devastation that wars wreak on nations, in people, on families. This is the war in Syria. And the devastation, the pain, the loss of life is absolutely unbelievable. So how do we address this darkness, the darkness that is external, the darkness that is in the world that we live in, and the darkness that is inside of us? Because it's so easy to point the fingers with others, and yet inside, it's in us. There's something that we need to birth in us. And I believe that's opening ourselves up to Jesus
and saying, Jesus, fill me. And then Jesus shines through the cracks. So I had a friend, his name is Shannon Smea. Shannon was a missionary kid in Latin America, and we worked together some. And one day he told me this story. He said, I wanted to take these girls that I knew to this cave and go exploring. And so I've been to this cave as well. It's called Skylight Cave. And he said, I stopped off at the local Nakumat. I picked up a torch with some ever-ready type batteries. And we went, we drove out to this place. We walked across the fields. We went into the cave. And in this particular cave, you go through a little bit and you come to this place where there's water. And in this water, there's only about that much space in between the top of the cave and the water. So you've got to get down into the water, submerge yourself, and float through this little narrow space. How many of you guys would like to do that? Exactly. Exciting. So he gets to the other side, and they're wowed by it. The girls are impressed. And as he gets a little further in, his torch starts to go out. He says, we got to go back quick. But before they could get back to the light, his torch completely went dead. He said, Brent, within moments, I didn't know which way I had come from or which way to go. I was so disoriented. I tried to tell the girls to stay there, and I would make my way by feeling, and he'd call back, can you still hear me? He said it was impossible. There was no possible way out of the darkness. 22 hours later, the police came and saved their lives. Because he had told his roommate, he said, we're going to a cave. They figured it out. What would it have taken for Shannon to get out of that cave? Would you need a really bright light like these ones or this one? All he would have needed was what? A match. Because when the darkness is the most, at that point, it illuminates, one little match illuminates things like you can't even believe. So it doesn't look bright when it's up here, but when there's darkness, the darkness has to flee before the light. I have an author that I like, his name is Richard, and he says this in a book on Advent, preparing for Christmas. Come, Lord Jesus. The Advent mantra means that all Christian history has to come to live out a kind of deliberate emptiness, a kind of chosen non-fulfillment. Perfect fullness is always to come, and we do not need to demand it now. This keeps the field of life wide open, and especially open to grace, and a future created by God rather than ourselves. This is exactly what the gospel means to be awake. We can also use other words for Advent: aware, alive, attentive, alert, awake. They're all appropriate. Advent is above all else a call to being conscious or present. And the world that we live in is constantly clamoring for us to want more, to be dissatisfied with what we have. How many of you have been to a mall recently? Are you kidding? Because there's about 50,000 malls in Nairobi, right? I mean, all you do is walk into a mall and you'll see Santas parachuting from the ceiling. You'll see big Christmas balls. You'll see sales. You'll see all different kinds of things that basically are calling out for you saying, in order to be happy, you need this. Look at this documentary on minimalism.
So many time on the hunt, but nothing ever quite does it for us. And we get so wrapped up in the hunt that it kind of makes us miserable.
Black Friday shopping mania is still playing out tonight in malls across America.
I hope so. Satan's a big bunch of those holiday gifts.
In some cases, it did turn violent.
We've, as a culture, have lost our minds.
Did you hear what he said? We, as a culture, have basically lost our minds. If you go into my house, you'll find I have too much stuff. Does anyone else have too much stuff? I have CDs that I don't listen to because I don't use CD players anymore. I use iPhone, right? Or I use an MP3 player. I have memorabilia. My favorite memorabilia item is this. This is the jacket that I had when I was a senior in high school in 1987. My name tag is on it right there, Brent Hansen. Yeah? And I just, it holds nostalgia for me. I went to Rift Valley Academy. Here it is, and it's cluttering my house. But everywhere we go, the billboards, you need this to be happy. And I, Sports Pesa, Bet In, all things that just say, wow, you have the potential to be different if you add more to your life. But the problem is, I think we need to have less in our lives. Not only less material items, but less things that begin to clutter our minds. Unfortunately, it's just like life happens and we become cluttered. Anxiety, resentment, judgments, self-pity, mistrust, negative, useless fears and worries, wounding messages, the loops that our mind get into over and over and over again. And society is helping us. You aren't good enough unless you have an iPhone 10X. I was looking at the nice Mac that you have back there, Pastor Julius, and I said, if only I could have one like that. I've had my same computer for 4 years. I need a new one. But I don't. I think what we need to understand is that if we empty ourselves and we ask God to fill us with His light, with His love, then regardless of how broken we are, because we're broken, God's light shines through the cracks and begins to transform the world. There's a book called The Cup of Life by Joyce Rupp, and this is what it says. Praying. Generous God, so many times I've come with my empty cup, a beggar of the heart, devoid of nourishment, depleted of energy, and you have filled. Generous God, so many times I've come afraid of unknowns and full of negatives and no's, fighting the challenges closed and resistant to growth, and you have opened. Generous God, so many times I've come a stranger to my spirit, crammed with cultural noise, caught in endless clutter, crowding my inner space, and you have emptied. Generous God, I come to you again, holding out my waiting cup, begging that it first be emptied of all that blocks the way, then asking for its filling with love that tastes like you. Can somehow we as Christians be different than others? Can we ask God to take away the things that clutter our lives and make the space as we await the full coming of Jesus into the world? I think that The kind of songs that we sing around Christmas sometimes. You guys heard this one? Want to sing it? Doesn't it sound so nice? The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. Not a sound he makes. I don't think that's true, Pastor Julius. That song is wrong. Babies cry. At least my baby did. Yeah, but we have this picture of this Jesus, this baby, this sweet little baby that came in. The cows are looking at him, the sheep in the pictures. Everything is perfect. But that's not the Jesus that the world needs today. The sweet picture of baby Jesus might evoke good feelings and a high cuteness factor. But I think God is calling the church to a deeper, broader view of Jesus. Back to Richard. The suffering, injustice, and devastation on this planet are too great to settle for any infantile Jesus. Jesus, Lord of all creation, was the rallying cry of the early church. It is to this adult and cosmic Christ that we are saying, "Come, Lord Jesus," which are the final words of the Bible. This makes our entire life and the life of the church one big advent about the time when Jesus comes. We just have to make space. There were two Buddhist monks that were walking down a road. I'm going to come down here. And they were walking down this path, and they came upon this wealthy lady that had all of these packages. And she was looking, and there was a river. And she didn't know how to cross, because she didn't want to spoil her clothes and her packages. So the older monk said to the lady, "Why don't you get on my back and I will carry you across the river?" That's exactly what happened. She got onto his back. They crossed the river. Wow. The river, and she offloaded. She never even said thank you or anything. She just walked on her way. So the two monks continue down the path, and after about 2 hours, the younger monk finally said, "I can't believe it. How can you let that go? That lady, you were so kind to her. You're all wet. Look at that. Aren't you upset?" And the older monk turned to the younger monk and said, "Why are you still carrying that lady? I let her go 2 hours ago." What do we carry in our hearts? What do we carry in us that fills us up with stuff and doesn't allow God's Spirit to come out? Because as we look to Tuesday, or we look at what's happening in Syria, or we look at what's happening in America, we look at President Trump, we look at the fights, we look at the world, we as Christians don't have the luxury of filling our lives with useless clutter. Because the world needs us to be full of light and love that Jesus gives us. And when we open ourselves and when we allow that space, all of a sudden, God's light can shine out and pierce the darkness and change the world. What differentiates me from anyone else? Do I think differently? Do I act differently? What difference has Jesus made in my life if the fruits that I bear are no different than anyone else. How is it that I can meet people of other religions and they're more Christ-like than me? Or people that don't even claim to know God, or an atheist, or a gay person? Because you know you can meet people that exhibit the love of Christ that are not full of Christ as we define it or define it. That's my challenge. What difference has Jesus and the coming of Jesus made in my life? Am I different? Do I have a different kind of love? Philip Yancey wrote a book called What's So Amazing About Grace. He said, virulent evil, racism, ethnic hatred spreads through society like an airborne disease. One cough infects an entire busload. The cure, like a vaccine, must be applied one person at a time. When moments of grace do occur, the world must pause, fall silent, and acknowledge that indeed forgiveness offers a kind of cure. The love, the light of Jesus should be exploding out of us. Guess who that is? That is my one and only daughter, Sienna. And she doesn't look like that anymore. She's 10 years old. But can you not look at that? I can't even look at that picture. A smile comes to my heart. My heart begins to expand as I think she's the cutest thing that ever was. See her little hippo on her shirt? I love that outfit. She's my daughter. I love her. Love explodes out of me when I look at her, when I'm around her. And I believe that's what God wants us to come out of us in the world. And I'm going to skip this clip. And I want to show you some pictures of what love in action looks like. Anthony is a barber. He's 82 years old. Every Wednesday, he brings his chair, his clippers, and a car battery to power the clippers to a local park. He then gives haircuts to the homeless. He doesn't charge them a dime. All they have to do is give him a hug. What does Jesus look like? The owner of a bakery in Turkey put bread out of his bakery and put a sign saying, if you are needy, take for free. Now, probably 99.9% of Turkey is Muslim, so there's a high probability that this Turkish baker is a Muslim. And yet, the love that's coming out of him reflects the light and love of Jesus. I'm trying to provoke. Because I believe that we as the church are in desperate need of being broken open so the life and light and love of Jesus comes out. A concert where your friend is in a wheelchair and needs to see. Look at this picture. Foreign invaders in your land. Do you spit on them? Or do you give them tea? Teaching. This guy runs in a local triathlon every year with his 13-year-old daughter. She has cerebral palsy. He pulls her in a kayak during a swim, in a cart during the bike, and pushes her in a wheelchair for the run. What does Jesus look like coming out of us? or a few behind. Classmate who has cancer. Sick child being visited by the police. I mean, the list, you just go on and Google touching pictures on, and you'll find so many amazing things that are happening where the love of Jesus can come out of us and can begin to change and transform the world. I'd like to read some scriptures together, and if the text is a little bit bigger, would you just shout it out a little bit louder? And this is comes from the verse for the month. The verse is found in John chapter 1. Can we read it together? The one who is the true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. Who? Everyone. Verse 14. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness. And we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. Verse 16. Sorry, that it left. I'll read it for you. From his abundance we have received one gracious blessing after another. And the last verse is found in verse chapter 17. And it reads, for the law was given through Moses, but God's unfailing love and faithfulness came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the unique one, who is himself God, is near to the Father's heart. He has revealed God to us. What do children have to say?
I have a lot of toys, but homeless people and food is even more important.
Sit right here for me. Awesome. Are you nervous at all?
Yes.
If you could have any wish, what would you do?
Hard one. A robot that would do everything for
just turn it up a little bit, baby.
Everybody. And then mention, I wish that we.
I could have superpowers.
To bend metal and bite it.
An endless pizza. You eat it, it comes back.
For more wishes for everyone, so they could get whatever they want. Like me.
Having a better life and like not struggle with like my mom seeing her like struggle with bills, so like have more money.
I would wish for like homeless people to not be homeless.
Change pollution.
Make a cure for cancer.
Travel around and give people hope.
World peace.
I watch the news a lot, so like I've noticed a lot of people getting killed or a lot of murders and stuff like that.
Sometimes the world makes me sad because people aren't educated enough to know about how unwise predators is.
I don't know why people fight so much. I think that because they're just mad or frustrated a little bit, or they've just had a bad day.
It's okay if everyone is different. God made us different ways.
If everyone treated people with love, then Earth would be a better place to live.
If you were to give a message to adults, what would your message be?
Stop. Look at what you're doing. Forget about money. And think about what you really care about.
Because if you don't do anything about it, like to not help it, then it just gets worse.
I think it's really important that we love each other.
If we all work together, we can change the world. We can make a difference.
Can you hear that?
Yeah.
Is that beautiful? Advent. One more quote and one more clip and I'm done. Come, Lord Jesus is a lead into the kind of freedom and surrender that is rightly called the virtue of hope. The theological virtue of hope is the patient and trustful willingness to live without closure, without resolution, and still be content and happy because our satisfaction is now at another level and our source is beyond ourselves. We are able to trust that he will come again just as Jesus has come into our past, into our private dilemmas, and into our suffering world. Our Christian past has then become our Christian prologue. And come, Lord Jesus, come is not a cry of desperation, but an assured shout of cosmic hope. Come, Lord Jesus, come. And as we empty ourselves and we ask for God's light and God's love to so fill us, imagine the power of Jesus working through and what light can actually do to darkness. If each one of us represents this little light that is amplified by the love and power of Jesus, who has come and is coming again in fullness, we will work together to change the world forever. Come, Lord Jesus, come.